Yeah.
A really warm good morning to everyone. I welcome our principal, Dr. Premlata Gupta Madam, our distinguished speaker of this session, Dr. Neeraj Chaurasia sir. I welcome from the bottom of my heart to this last session of the FDP program, the first session of this FDP program in the last day, that is 12th June 2021. My heartiest welcome to our heads of the Institute of Science and Research, IPS Academy, Dr. Pradeep Joshi, sir, Department of Mathematics, Dr. Sanjay Nagar, sir, Department of Biotechnology, Dr. Jitendra Tripathi, sir, Department of Physics, Professor Ruchi Srivastav, ma'am, Department of Chemistry, and Mrs. Sapna Jojhari, ma'am, Department of Library and Information Science. I also extend my heartiest welcome to all our enthusiastic participants, colleagues, and team members in this last day of our FDP event. It gives me an immense pleasure to introduce our resource person of today's session, Dr. Neeraj Chaurasia. Dr. Neeraj Chaurasia, sir, is Deputy Central Library and is Head of Hindi Cell at IIT Delhi. Sir has published several books, contributed in more than 60 research papers in edited books, journals, and conference proceedings in Hindi and English. He is a member of editorial board of reputed international and national journals of library science. Sir is the managing editor of Jigyasa, published by Hindi Cell IIT Delhi. Dr. Chaurasia had acted as expert member, examiner, to various professional bodies, institutions, and universities. He has been member of organizing committees, advisory committees, resource person, invited speaker, keynote speaker, session chair in various national and international conferences, seminars, and workshops. Sir has been conferred with many awards, such as SLA Engineering Library Award 2020 from Engineering Division, the Special Librarian Association Award in 2020 in USA. Dr. Chaurasia sir received the SLA Asian SciTech Librarian Award 2019 by Asian Chapter, SLA, at Cleveland, Ohio, USA, and Engineering Institution Librarian of the Year Award 2018 by MPLA. He has vast experience in library technologies, e-resources consortia management, RFID implementation, digitization of library resources, emerging technologies for library management and services, library networks, books, and other automation-related activities in libraries. I take the honor to welcome Dr. Neeraj Chaurasia, sir, to this one-week National Faculty Development Program on advanced opportunities and implicit research technologies in sciences. Sir, a very warm good morning to you and kindly accept our heartiest welcome and thank you for accepting our invitation. May I now request our dynamic leader and our beloved principal, Dr. Premlata Gupta ma'am, to welcome our guest and say a few words to us. Dr. Gupta ma'am.
It is indeed a great pleasure and honor for IPS Academy to have our distinguished guest, Dr. Chaurasia from IIT Delhi, and our respected participants and colleagues. I extend a very warm welcome to all of you on this digital platform from the Institute of Science and Research, IPS Academy. Now, this is the last day of our successful faculty development program, last day and last session. So I congratulate whole organizing team, convener, and all participants. Our central library is attractive one because of its state-of-art facility. We have more than 46,000 books and more than 7,200 journals in hard copy. We have more than 24 newspapers, number of magazines in hard copy, apart from soft copies. We have softwares, and all these facilities are in our 4 big library. I once again welcome and congratulate all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Without your support and motivation, we wouldn't have been able to accomplish this 1 week FDP program. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
May I request, sir, to kindly address the gathering of a huge participation of above 950 participants, and I am continuing with the keynote lecture, Resources for Academic Excellence. Over to you, sir.
Very good morning to all of you. And thank you very much, madam, for giving such a wonderful introduction. Let me first congratulate the IPS Academy for successfully conducting this 1 week FTP on advanced opportunities and implicit research technologies in sciences. At the very outset, let me also thanks to the organizers for inviting me to deliver this talk in this FTP. It's a pleasure for me to be associated with this, with IPS Academy. I think I am the last speaker of the day. And in the first lecture related to library, you have heard Dr. Sandeep Kumar Pathak, who wonderfully provided the glimpse and live demo about the various plagiarism tools, Turnitin, Urkund, etc. He's a very good friend of mine. When I received a call from the organizers, it was told that you have to speak on electronic resources. I agreed on that because this is a very interesting topic for me, because in IIT Delhi, we were having a biggest consortia, e-resource consortia of India. That was the INDEST AICT consortia, Indian National Digital Library for Engineering Sciences and Technology. In associated with AICT, this was one of the consortia of Ministry of HRD at that time, and currently Ministry of Education. So this was one of the most successful consortia in India, and that was established in 2003, and it was merged with some other government consortia and was working fine up to 2013, up to 2016. So it was a great experience to work in such a biggest consortia of India, as sometime as a coordinator or sometime as in other capacities. And I'd like to tell you that this consortia was having three kind of membership. One was core membership, then AICT members, and third one was the self-supporting membership. So if I am remembering correctly, then IPS Academy was also one of the member of that AICT, INDEST AICT consortia. Right. I will have to see the details, but I still remember that IPS Academy was the member of that biggest consortia of India as a self-supporting member. And under that, they were subscribing number of good resources from the INDEST consortium. So it was a good experience for working in this consortia. So the topic for today's talk is the e-resources for academics and research. I have added in this topic term digital content because both are interrelated. E-resources and digital content both are very much relevant for the academics and research. I have added this digital content because lot of efforts are being there from the government, from the autonomous organizations, from the individuals who are really help in providing the good resources, good services to the academics and research community. So the topic for presentation would be the e-resources and digital content for the academics and research. Could you provide me the permission for share the screen, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Is it visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay, fine, fine. So the topic is already telling number of things what I am going to discuss, but in my presentation I will be providing the insights about the electronic resources, what kind of resources are available for research and academics, and how you can use effectively these resources. Apart from the subscribed resources by the library, there are number of very good free resources which are available in public domain. I would like to cover those resources. So this would be the outline of today's presentation. I will be covering the electronic resources, which is known as e-resources. What are the resources available? Why we need these electronic resources? What are the various forms of these resources? Forms and types, also the availability from where these are available, and how you can access these resources. So I will be talking about all these relevant content of e-resources. Apart from that, I will also talk about the library e-resource consortia initiatives under that, how these institutions, how these universities and colleges are benefited out of these consortia. I will also discuss about the open access free resources which are available in public domain for the scholars and users. Some of the digital learning material initiatives and e-content from Ministry of Education. There are a number of initiatives from government agencies, organizations. They have created a lot of digital content and resources, and which is freely available for the research and academic purpose. There are a number of open access data resources which might be very useful for the users who are doing research in different fields. So I will be talking about that also. And most important point is how these electronic resources subscription can be helpful for the institute ranking. Because I was going through the platform, the website of IPS Academy. I found that you are also participating in number of institute rankings, including the India Today rankings, Outlook, and NIRF, etc. How you can use these electronic resources more appropriately. That is also very important, because what is happening sometimes when you are subscribing number of resources and not following the guideline, then sometimes the libraries or the institutions are in trouble, because there are a number of resources for which the library or the librarian is signing the license agreements, and we are not following the guidelines of the resources or the publishers, sometimes we will be facing the problem. So I will be talking about that also. So friends, in this era of information explosion, you can see lot of information is publishing every year. Every day it is doubling sometime. So the knowledge is also publishing in different formats. The electronic resources are, or you can say e-content, are increasingly important component of collection building of library. When you talk about the library, as Madam rightly said, that they are subscribing number of print journals. Apart from that, also subscribing some of the e-content. So what is happening currently, the libraries, they are not only purchasing the print collection, they will be having the hybrid collection. Hybrid means print as well as the electronic resources. So most of the libraries, they will be having that kind of resources. If you talk about the information landscape of current information landscape, you will be finding that the information is publishing in various format. It may be books, it may be e-books, sometime it may be web resources or digital information is available. Apart from that, you will find a lot of e-resources archives are available in different formats. So information landscape is very very different current time. So what libraries are doing, the aim of the library is, basic aim of library is to provide quick and comprehensive access of resources by using best possible tools and techniques. There are a number of tools and techniques available. I will also try to cover some of the tools and techniques which can be helpful to provide the effective subscription of resources to the users. Now the users are also changed. They want print resources and also the electronic resources. So users' performance has been changed, and we as a library or library science professional, this is our responsibilities to fulfill the demand of the users. So instead of having the print only, we should subscribe the hybrid collection in the library. If you see last few decades, the advent of electronic journals has called a greatest revolution. In past 2-3 decades, when these print journals were published, there was no electronic journals. Then you can see the publishing trend, or you can see the productivity of the individual institutions. You will find lot of difference in current scenario when we are having lot of information in electronic format, and the previous decades when we were having only print. So the productivity of the institutions, the productivity of the scholars is increased because of increased access of electronic resources. Friends, most of the academicians currently are becoming internet dependent, and they want each and everything on their laptop or desktop or any other device, whatever they are having. Thanks to the internet and IT, because of that, the process, or you can say storing or searching or dissemination of information is very easy. It is very friendly, and within no time they will be able to get the information whatever they want. And e-resources are available with increased accessibility beyond the space restriction. There is no issue of space, because what is happening sometimes, if we are subscribing any journal in print format, we have to bound all the issues which are coming in a year, because we have to show to the audit or any agency who is visiting to your institution. So sometimes there are space limit in the libraries. We are subscribing online, then there is no such kind of issues. Today, digital technology is available at our doorstep. And Charles Judd, who had conceived the idea of universal library, I think that is slowly coming up. Friends, you know that the publishing industry is very competitive now. The publishers, the vendor, the publishers, publishing agencies, they are coming out with number of products. They are now coming out with number of different kind of products, and with the competitive price or competitive models, or you can say the competitive parameters of the resources. So we as a librarian, we are a little bit in difficulty that what we should purchase, what not. Now, coming to the main point, e-resources. E-resources mainly covers the electronic journals, e-books, all type of databases, e-images, and number of other content. These content are different from other library material because complexity of license agreement. When we are talking about these electronic resources, what we are doing basically, we don't have anything in our hand. Everything is available on publisher's server, and they are extending the access to the libraries or to the users. Okay, so in case of print books, those books are available to us. But in case of electronic resources, libraries or the institutions are just signing the agreements. They don't have anything on their hand. So there are a lot of complexities in the license agreements. This is one of the things which makes e-resources different from the print books. Need to set up the access. Whenever you are subscribing any electronic resource, any electronic journal or database, you need to have access or set up the access. If you are subscribing for whole year, then access will be set up from the January up to the December or in between. So there is need to set up the access. Without access setup, you cannot access the resources, because you need to provide the IP range and other things and the detail of your institution. Confusion over pricing model. In case of print books, you will find that sometimes the price is fixed, and we can have the price from the publisher website and other places. But in case of journals, there is no fixed price. It's a little bit confusing, and sometimes we are not able to find what are the actual price of the resources. These resources are available from various publishers, sometimes aggregators, sometimes vendors, or sometimes library consortia. So this is also one of the issues from where we should subscribe these resources. Sometimes on the more than one platform, like IPS Academy, they are subscribing resources from the NList, as I know. So, sometimes they are subscribing their own. So it is little bit difficult for the library or librarians from where you should subscribe the resources. So these are some of the complexities. And I think these are more related to the libraries, but purpose of this discussion is to users should know that how these e-resources are difficult from the or different from the print resources. Now, we've already discussed about that, like there are number of different kind of e-resources like books, journals, databases, conference proceedings. Whenever these conferences are happening, these are also coming out in electronic format. E-theses, e-reports, maps, newspapers, a number of things are there. These are comes out under the electronic resources terms about which we will be talking. So how these are available? These are subscribed or procured by the library or the consortia. And second place is open access or free resources. Number of websites are there, number of platforms are there from you can find the resources. So these are the two ways of getting the accessibility or availability of resources. These are the modes of subscription, like you can directly subscribe from the publishers, or you can subscribe the resources from the consortia. Maybe ESOPSINDU, NKRC, or DRDO. We'll talk a little bit in detail how you can access, how you are accessing the resources. Sometimes these are IP based. Whenever you are subscribing any resource, you have to provide your IP range of your college. So the resources will be available on that IP range. And because of that, if you are living in the campus, you will be able to access those resources which are subscribed by the library or by the institution. Similarly, there are other way like UID and password based. So you can have access using the UID password also. Now, these are the types of various resources. Apart from that, there are full text resources, there are citation databases or bibliographic databases, there are ebooks, e-standards, academic writing tools are there, remote access tools are there. As Madam Works rightly said, they are also having some of the softwares which are also coming under the e-resources. I'm talking about the IIT Delhi, whatever fund we are getting in our institution, we are subscribing all these things from that budget, because there is no resource which are permanently procured or hired. These are basically having the subscription. So all these resources are based on the subscription. Now, what are the full text resources or journals package or bundles or databases? I was going through the website of IPS Academy. I saw that IPS Academy is running number of courses, number of disciplines they have. So what kind of resources should be available there? What kind of resources a particular subject should have? I try to list out some of the important resources which may be bread and butter for the any discipline, like ACS is the American Chemical Society journals. ACS is publishing number of good journals. And if you are doing your research in chemistry or chemical engineering or textile, this may be one of the very important resource for the chemistry people or the chemical engineers. Similarly, for the American Institute of Physics, or you can say the IOP, that is the Institute of Physics, or you can say the OSA, that is the Optical Society of America. These are the important resources for the research scholars or the faculty members who are doing research in the field of physical sciences or physics. Similarly, for the mathematics, AMS is the society, American Mathematical Society is the society who is publishing good journals in the field of mathematics. Similarly, for the civil engineering, ASC, one of the society who is publishing the journals in the field of civil engineering, and ASME for mechanical engineering. Similarly, there are a number of other products which are there, and you can subscribe these resources for the research scholar, for the faculty members of your institution. Like this RSC Gold is the basically covered the journals which are related to chemistry. and the JSTOR is there. A number of good resources are there for the peoples or for the scholars and faculty members who are doing research in different fields. Having this legal and law department, or if you are having such scholars or faculty members who are teaching this law or legal things, then this India Stat or Manupatra, I was discussing with Madam, librarian Madam or the HOD Madam, she was telling that we are having the access of Manupatra. Manupatra is also a very good resource, but apart from that, there are a number of good resources like Westlaw, LexisNexis, this Walter Kluwer's and SSCC. There are a number of good resources which are really helpful for the users if they are doing research in that particular field. Similarly, if you are having management department or business or finance or economics, you need to have access of company or financial data, market research reports, industry data, country information data, number of information or number of resources are required. So you can see these are the publishers, these are the resources which are very much required for the research scholar who are doing research in this field, like ProQuest, EBSCO, EMIS, CMIE, Euromonitor, Bloomberg, Harvard. These are very reputed publishers or publishing agencies. I think IBS Academy is having access of EBSCO Business Source Complete. That is very important database for the research scholar who is doing research in management, right? Similarly, one important database from the ProQuest, that is the ABI Inform, which covered more than 7,000 journals. So these are very important resources for the scholars who are doing research in that particular field. Similarly, for ebooks, apart from the print books, there are a number of publishers who are publishing the print books, publishing the electronic books, and there are different kind of models which are available sometimes. These models are like one-time purchase, means you purchase books one time, and you will be having the access for whole year or whole life. Whole life means they have fixed some 10-15 years. So these are called perpetual access kind of model. And apart from that, you will be having the access of subscription-based, means you pay for a year, and you will be having access for that particular year only. So number of publishers are there which are publishing number of ebooks which may be helpful for the readers. Now coming to the another important point, that is the citation databases, bibliographical database, or some of the important other databases. Talk about the bibliographical databases. Some of the important databases are like Scopus, Web of Science, Indian Citation Index, MathSciNet, Cypher, many more such kind of bibliographic or citation resources. If you want to see the publications of the individual author, individual institution, these Web of Science, Scopus, or Indian Citation Index may be very helpful. We'll talk about a little more in next slides. MathSciNet is one of the conversion of mathematical review. If you are from the mathematics field, earlier, about 20 years back, there were mathematical reviews. Now mathematical reviews are coming in the form of MathSciNet. This is one of the database. If you subscribe to this database, you will be having the access of all kind of these mathematical reviews. Similarly, for SciFinder Scholar, this is one of the database. You can say this is the bread and butter for the research scholar who are doing research in the field of chemistry, chemical sciences, or textile. Without this, research cannot be completed. This is very important database, or previously it was known as Chemical Abstracting Services. This is from the Chemical Abstracting Services, CAS. And similarly for the SAGE research method, this is also one of the very important resource. If you are planning to do the research, how you should do the research, different kind of guides are available under that. How these citation databases are helpful for the users, for the research scholars, these are very helpful because if you are subscribing this, if you are having access of Scopus, Web of Science, you will be very helpful for your whenever you are doing your literature survey. So if you are writing your literature review, then citation databases are very helpful in that, because you will be knowing what kind of research has already been published by the various scholar, by the various faculty members, and by the various institutions. Similarly, you will be able to find out from where you can find the funds for your individual research. You will be finding number of funding agencies information in that. Apart from that, you will be able to find out who are the who may be the tentative collaborator for you, who is doing the research in that particular field. Similarly, you will be able to find out the research trend, what kind of research is happening in the world, what kind of research is happening in the country. You will be able to find out that kind of information in these citation databases, maybe Scopus, maybe Web of Science. You will be find out a very important area where you have to submit the article, because sometimes the users or budding scholars, they are very much confused where to submit this article. So you will be able to find out the proper journals. You will be able to find out and analyze the journal to where you have to submit the research of your individual research. And more importantly, you will also be able to find out the total number of publications of individual faculty members, of individual research scholars, or individual institution, including the citations count and also the H-index of individual institutions or research scholars. So these are very important for the research scholar or the faculty members. Talking about this SCI, I think you might be aware about this, that Science Citation Index is now coming out in the form of Web of Science. So this was one of the citation index which was published in 1964, and now currently this is the property of Clarivate Analytics. This is the publisher who is providing the access of Web of Science. Earlier it was from some routers, and initially it was from the ISI. So there are four type of indexes in Web of Science. First one is Science Citation Index, which is also known as SCI. Then SSCI, which is known as Social Science Citation Index, Arts and Humanities Citation Index, and some of the other indexes. These are the four indexes which are there in Web of Science. So if you are doing research in humanities and social sciences, then you should consider this SSCI. If you are doing research in science, then Science Citation Index would be the right choice for you. And Arts and Humanities is for the humanities people who is doing research. Web of Science is published initially in 1964, and it covers more than 11,500 journals and more than 1 lakh of conference proceedings online. So this is the coverage which I have tried to given a glimpse about the Web of Science. Similarly, for the Scopus, you can say this is one of the competitor of Web of Science, which was published by the Elsevier Publishers in 2004, and it covers more than 18,000 journals. I heard some of the video of Dr. Singh, I think it was yesterday, he was talking about this UGC care list of journals or something like that. So this is also one of the good source of getting to know that in which journals we need to publish. So Elsevier Scopus is having one of the important field, that is the source titles, what kind of journals they are covering in Scopus. So those journals are basically the right journals, because they have indexed based on the certain criteria, whatever criteria they are having. About 18,000 journals are covered in Scopus. Likewise, in Web of Science, they covered about 12,000 journals. Source data is from 1960, means suppose you want to see the citation of any kind of institution, any person, then it will be available from 1960 only. This is one of the limitation of Scopus. Now, one important free resource is Google Scholar. I think most of you might be using it. This is free. It was launched in 2004. And important thing is coverage is very wide. And if you are not having your profile in this Google Scholar, please create one Gmail account and visit this Google Scholar and create your profile and start adding your publications, whatever you are having. Because once you created your Google Scholar profile, it is automatically adding the research papers which it find in your name. Sometimes it may be wrong. which you can delete from the Google Scholar platform. So try to use this Google Scholar platform if you are not having access of this Web of Science or Scopus. It is always good to have the access to have the profile of Google Scholar, because you will be able to find out what is your H index, who is citing your work. This is very important tool. Now coming to another important tool, that is the JCR. I think you might be knowing about that, General Impact Factor. So this JCR is the property of Clarivate Analytics, who is providing access to the Web of Science. So this is important, and they are providing access of JCR as well. So JCR, what JCR is doing, they are coming out every year, one of the edition every year, and they are publishing the impact factor of individual journal. Like you can see, I have taken a screenshot from the JCR, and I found that you can see this, like second one, new NEJM, that is called as NEJM, New England Journal of Medicine. If you are doing research in medical field, then NEJM is very good journal, because it has higher impact factor than other journals. Okay. Similarly for the others, like Journal of Clinics, it has impact factor of 292. And so this is one of the very important resource. And I'd like to tell you that if you are not having access of JCR, because this is also a subscription based resource, if you are not having access of JCR, please visit to some JGate, some of the free tools from where you can at least find the JCR of last year. Okay, you can find freely available this JCR of last year. Definitely not for this year, because this is based on the subscription, but you will be able to find out what is the, where this journal stands, what is the impact factor of that individual journal. So you should know that if you are doing your research in the field of humanities, there is no JCR, because it has been found that as a scholar or faculty members, most of the faculty members, they are trying to publish these papers, or they are just trying to publish the books instead of journals. So this Web of Science doesn't cover JCR, or they are not providing any kind of impact factor for the humanities journals. So now I think you should know how this impact factor is being calculated. It is very simple. Because if anybody is telling that this impact factor is 20, then how it is being calculated? It is very simple. How? What they are doing is they are taking 2 years window of the publications. Okay, so the total number of papers published in last 2 years and the total number of citations they received those papers, that is the combination of getting the impact factor. So total number of citations received in last two years for that particular journal, and total number of articles published in that particular journal in last 2 years. So citations are divided by the total number of articles. This is how this impact factor is being calculated. Suppose you want to calculate the impact factor for any journal for 2019, you have to have the information about the total citations received by that particular journal in last 2 years, means 17 and 18, and you have to divide those total number of papers published in last 2 years. So this is how the impact factor is being calculated. Suppose you want to this H index is also one of the very important area. You should know about that. If you are telling that impact factor is this, then how it is being calculated. Before discussing this H index, I would like to tell you one important thing. Like if you are publishing, if you are trying to find out the good journal in your field, you have to consult this JCR, and you will find out impact factor may be one of the criteria apart from the other criteria. So if it is a good impact factor journal, then you can publish your paper in that. Please keep in mind, when you are publishing in any journal, you are going to publish any journal, please see that. Sometimes they are telling you that the impact factor of my journal is 2, 5 or 10. Please go through the JCR and see whether this is covered in this JCR or not. Because all the journals which are published in Web of Science, all journals are having the impact factor. some of the fidelity journals, or you can say the fake journals, they are claiming that we are having the impact factor, such kind of impact factor, but this is not true actually. That is not true. So you should always be careful while selecting a good journal for your publication. Now coming to the H-Index, Web of Science, Scopus, or Google Scholar, these are the sources from where you can get the H-Index. These are the citation databases, these are these resources, e-resources from where you can get the H-Index of individual. So how it is being calculated, you should also know about that. So this is the simple definition which was given by the H.E. Hriss. This was the concept of a physicist, which was given in 2005. And it was said that the H-Index, a scholar with index of H has published H papers and each has cited at least H times. So that is the formula for calculating the H-Index. How? If a faculty has published 207 papers, you can see this graph. This faculty has published 207 papers and received 1,623 citations, and his H-Index is 20 because his 20 papers has received more than 20 or more citations. So this is how this H-Index is being calculated. Similarly for this, this author has published 8 papers and received 33 citations, and finally H-Index is 6 because his paper has received 6 citations. This is another example. His five papers has received at least 6 citations, so H-Index could be 6. So this is one of the screenshots from the Scopus. You can see this is automatically calculated. H-Index is automatically calculated in Scopus. So this author has published a good number of papers and his H-Index is 52 because you can see this. This is yellow one. This 52 papers has received at least 52 citations, so H-Index would be 52. Similarly, in Web of Science, this H-Index is 55 because you see this blue line. This is automatically calculated. This 55 papers has received at least 55 citations, so H-Index would be 55. Similarly, in this Google Scholar also, like I have created this page, and how much citations, how much H-Index, how much item index I have, this will give you the information about that. SciFinder, I have already discussed about this. This is very important tool for the people who are doing research in the field of chemistry or chemical sciences. Indian Citation Index is also one of the good tool or good resource from the India, like Web of Science or Scopus. It covers more than 1,000 journals which are published in India. And this is indexed, all these journals which are published in India. This is also one of the paid platform. Now, there are a number of electronic resources, e-resources in the form of standards like ISO, BIS, standard, Bureau of Indian Standards, International Standard, ASTM, and many more. These are also coming now in the electronic format. These are some of the academic writing tools, which also comes under the category of e-resources, Turnitin, Authenticate, Urquhart, and number of other resources, number of other plagiarism checking tools, plagiarism detection tool. Dr. Pathak has already discussed a lot about this. Grammarly is very important tool. I think if you are not aware about that, please try to download free Grammarly software. What it is doing, basically, whenever you are publishing any paper, you are publishing your research, you are publishing your thesis, you check once through the Grammarly, because it will tell you what kind of grammatical mistakes are there, what kind of sentences errors are there. It will help you to find out those kind of errors. And in the free version, all kind of facilities are not available, but you can at least find out the basic things out of this Grammarly. At IT Delhi, we are subscribing the premium version of Grammarly, and which has a lot of features, including this plagiarism, initial plagiarism. So you try to download this free Grammarly software and create your account and start using it. It is important to mention here that the good number of publications are rejected because of grammatical issues, right? So grammar should be good whenever you are publishing your paper in any kind of research papers. a number of reference management tools like Mendeley, Zotero, EndNote. So I definitely might be using these resources, but if you are not using these, please try to use these, Mendeley or EndNote. These are free tools which are available. And EndNote is the property of this Clarivate Analytics, who is publishing this Web of Science. So what you have to do is, and just want to show you that from where you can download this. You go to the Web of Science platform. You can see this screen. I have circled this just here. Apart from that, there is one tab, EndNote. So just click on that and create your this thing account in that and start using that. Similarly, the Mendeley is the platform of Xavier Science, who is publishing this Scopus. So if you are using EndNote, there is no need of Mendeley. So start using any of these reference management tools. Definitely will be very helpful for research scholars, because what is happening when you are submitting any paper to any publishers, and if it is rejected, then you are going to change complete citation styles, reference managing style, and everything. So if you are using any tool, such kind of tool, you are able to automatically change these styles of referencing. One another important tool is Overleaf, which is one of the collaborative latest data-based platform. All these platforms we are having access at IEEE. Another important field is single window search. I talked about lot of platforms. I talked about number of resources, but important thing is you should also be knowing what kind of how you will be using these resources more effectively, because what is happening sometimes, you are not in a position to visit different kind of websites, different kind of platforms. So these single window search will be very helpful, because what is happening sometimes, we are spending crores of rupees on subscription of journals, ebooks, and other things, but we are not able to utilize those resources. So single window search platform is very important, playing a great role in that. Like EBSCO Discovery Service, this is providing integrated search, single window search like Google, and you will be integrating all resources, all kind of resources at one platform, and you will be accessing all your resources from one single search. Similarly, Nimbus, Summon, and number of free tools are available. So I think IPS Academy is having the access of Nimbus, and it is good because the resources which you are subscribing will be effectively used. Otherwise, the crores of rupees are sometimes wasted because user might not be aware whatever you are subscribing. So once it is integrated to the single window search, user will be getting the results out of all the resources. Like I just want to show this screenshot of our library. You can see this. We have all kind of journals. We have integrated all books. We have integrated the online catalog of our library. We have integrated the institutional repositories, all pieces, audio visual material. So this is one of the single window search. And whenever this user is putting a query in this window, they will be able to find out the results out of all the resources, whatever they are subscribing. So this is a very good tool for the access. Now coming to the remote access tools or off-campus tools, I would like to put much emphasis on that, because during this current pandemic, it is very difficult to access the resources, whatever the institutions are subscribing, because most of the users, most of the students, they are not in the campus. They are away from the campus, but using these remote access tools, it is very easy to access the tools which are access the resources which are subscribed by the library. So like virtual private network is there, remote access platform is there, and similarly open access, this Shibboleth is there, which is maintained by the Internet Center Gandhinagar, from where you are subscribing, IPS Academy is subscribing this and list resources. Open access is there, EZ Proxy is there. These are some of the tools which are very helpful for providing the easy access of resources for the users. Now coming to the e-resource consortia, this is also a very important point, because user should know, as a user, you should know how you are getting the access. Sometimes what is happening, the user are just putting the query in Google and they are trying to access the resources, whatever they want. They are trying to getting the access of individual article, but they sometimes they are getting, but they don't know how they are getting the access, because it is directly going to the subscribe resources. If it is subscribed, then they will be getting the access. If it is not subscribed, they will not be getting the access. But in my opinion, the Google is not the right place from where you should search. I've already talked about that, that if you are having access of such kind of services like Discovery Service or Nimbus or some other platform, please try to use that, because Google is not providing the complete results, whatever you want, because it will give you hundreds of results, thousands of results for a query, but it might not be relevant for your research. So if you talk about the consortia, you should know what kind of education system we are having here in India. So I got some of the figures from the NIRF ranking 2020. The higher education system in India is very large and complex. There are more than 800 universities, more than 40,000 affiliated colleges, and a good number of teaching faculty, research scholars and students, and enrolled every year. You see the enrollment, it is quite high. Earlier it was 2 lakhs in 1947, and currently it is more than 250 lakhs in a year. So you can see how this system is, how big this system is. This is largest higher education system behind the China and United States, right? So how this consortia initiatives are helping? If you see the current scenario of the education system, number of colleges or universities or the institutions, they are facing acute shortage of funding. They are not getting the funds which are actually required for the subscription of journals or the tools. Most of the colleges, sometimes they are not having any kind of international journals or databases. So since 2003, when this consortia initiative came in India, and first consortia was established by the UGC, that was the UGC Infinet Consortia, and was established in Gandhinagar, Ahmedabad, and they created a good culture of accessing the electronic resources. And this was the reason, because different library consortia in India have successfully infused a good culture of having the electronic resources in their libraries. So definitely I can say that this has certainly benefited the higher education system of India. Consortia initiatives lead to increase the productivity of scientific research output, both the quality and quantity. There are a number of studies which shows that while these consortia initiatives came, there are increased productivity of scientific research output of individual research scholars or faculty members. And also the such productivity of scientists and research scholars and the beneficiary institutions has been increased while having the access of electronic resources. If you are having the access good of resources, definitely research output will be high. And if this research output is high, then definitely you will be having good citations, you will be having the good H-index, you will be having the contribution in particular field, and finally it is directly affecting to the ranking of the institutions. Quality of teaching, research and publication scientists and scholars are impacted in the accessibility of resources. Increased price of resources. If you see current scenario, there are a number of publishers who are dominating, and sometimes it is very difficult for the libraries to subscribe the resources. There are monopoly of the publishers and they don't want to come down to the pricing. So in that, this consortia initiatives are playing a great role. And sometimes in the financial crunch, the libraries are highly benefited with these consortia initiatives. I'd like to tell you, currently there are these about 10 consortia which are working in India. some are government funded consortia, some are funded by the individual institutions, but these are successful consortia which are currently running in India. So first one is ESOT Sindhu consortia. This is the consortia which is running by the Ministry of Education, and the headquarter of this consortia is in Tribute Center, Gandhinagar. So initially I was talking about the Indest AICT consortia, which was the handled by the this IIT Delhi. Now that consortia is merged with this ESOT Sindhu consortia, and these are coming out with these are including all kind of centrally funding technical institutions like IITs, NITs and others, and all kind of state universities, central universities, and number of deemed universities. DA consortia is one of the consortia which is from the atomic energy. Similarly, for the NKRC, that is the knowledge resource consortia from the CSIR, all the CSIR institutions are getting resources from NKRC. Similarly, for the RMED, this is from the medical consortia, MCIT for IT, ELCON, the biotechnology institutions, SERA for ICAR, agriculture institutions, DRDO for the defense institutions. So you can see how this consortia culture is there in India, because they will be having the good negotiation power with the consortia when they are having the access of, when they are coming to the negotiation. So if you are subscribing the journal for individual institutions, pricing will be definitely high. But when you are subscribing good number of institutions, the pricing would be really, really low for those institutions. So this consortia culture is very much going on in India, and effectively losing by the number of institutions in India. Now coming to the another important point, that is the free resources. If you see the institutions, as I talked about the publishing field initially, the information is doubling every year. So it is very difficult for the libraries or the institutions to subscribe all kind of resources which are published by the publishers. So these free resources or open access resources are playing a great role, right? So what kind of resources are available in public domain, we will try to see that. Open access resources doesn't mean that you copy and paste. These are resources freely available, but you should always try to give proper credit whatever you are getting. And these are the unrestricted resources which are available for the use of users, and very important resources, barrier free resources, and this kind of resources are freely available. You can see number of journals, number of ebooks, ETDs, NDLI is there, number of education courseware is there, are there, open learning tools are there, and number of video lectures and number of miscellaneous electronic tools are there. So I will just going few slides to show what kind of resources are freely available. So first thing is, what kind of open access journals or platforms are available? Directory of Open Access Journal is the biggest platform. This is one of the platforms from where you will be having access of 14,500 journals and good number of articles from more than 130 countries. And open access doesn't mean that these are fake, these will include the free journals. It is not like that. Fake journals, it is not like that. They have proper reviewing process. Journals, they have proper guide for those journals without fulfilling the their required information or required guideline. They are not including any journal in the platform. So UAJ is very important platform. You can use this platform. It is very important. Journal of Digital Information is a free journal which is published information in the reputed field. Sage Open, Sage is the publisher who is coming out with this Sage Open platform. So this is the link for accessing the journals which are freely available to the users. You can click on this, you will find journals which are available in, basically they are publishing in social science and behavioral science and humanities. You will be able to access all those free journals. Internet Archive is another platform from where you can find out number of good journals. Similarly, the Springer Open, Springer is the publisher, but from the Springer Open portfolio, you will be able to get the some of the journals which are freely available in the field of science, technology, humanities and social sciences. And similarly, digital library archives. These are good platform for having the access. After this lecture, I will be leaving this presentation with the organizers. These all are hyperlinked. So whenever you click this, you will directly able to go to that particular platform. So I will be sharing this platform, presentation with the organizers. This is the TOAJ platform. You will be seeing a good good number of searching options. Now another important platform is this electronic journal library. You can see this. If you see the green one with this journal, you will be able to find freely. This is a very good platform for access. Now coming to the open access ebooks. Directory of open access books. This is a very good platform like open access DOAJ. Project Gutenberg, Hathi Trust Digital Library. These are some of the initiatives who are providing you free ebooks, PDF Drive, BookBoon, or get free ebooks or Internet Archive. These are the platforms from where you can access the ebook. This is the platform of DOAB. Hathi Trust Digital Library is very important platform, and what they are doing is this Gutenberg project is doing. They have more than 60,000 free ebooks in the form of Kindle also. You can download these books as per your requirement. Open textbook platform is another platform from where you will find out the textbooks actually, textbook in particular field. So start using this platform. This is the platform developed by the State University of New York Libraries and supported by the Sun Innovative Technology. So you can see how you can search this platform. Hathi Trust Digital Library is another platform. It's a digital repository of scanned books, journals, and other library material. And this is also one of the very good source of getting the scanned copy of books. So try to go through this, and definitely you will be benefited out of these free tools. Million project, book project is also one of the very good platform. Under that, good number of books are being digitized, and you will be able to get the free access of these books. If you want to access the electronic thesis and dissertations, I think you might be aware about this Sodranga, which is one of the repository developed by the UGC and responsibility is with the National Gandhinagar. Similarly, with the NDLTD, this NDLTD is the platform where the 125 member universities are contributing this network digital library dissertations. So it will provide you the full text thesis which are submitted across the world, about 125 members. PQDT is another platform. This is from the Quest Publishers. EBSCO Open Digitations is also providing the free electronic thesis and digitization. So try to use these free tools which are there. These are some of the global ETDs. If you want to access any individual portal, you can just click on these links. You will be find out the full text thesis only. Now, you also have number of services from Google. So how you can use those Google services for academic research? First thing is Google Books. Google is also, you might be using this platform for accessing the ebooks. So Google Books are there, Google Scholar is there. I've already talked about that. Google Patent Search is there. That is very important now. Google Dataset Search is there, which are providing the data sets which you might be using for your research and academic purpose. So these are the four major initiatives from the Google, which can be used by the faculty members and researchers. Now coming to the some of the open courseware which can be used by you, like MIT course open courseware is very good tool for you, which has more than 2400 courses which are available. The content is very, very useful, and just go through it. The idea behind this was to publish all of courses material online and make them widely and freely available to everyone. So this is MIT courseware is very good tool for you. You can access it. Similarly, the Coursera is the worldwide online learning platform. MOOCs course is there, and it works with the universities and other organizations to offer online courses. So try to use this platform. Merlot is another important open education learning resource, and this is the repository which provides the access to the curated open access online collection of OER, open educational resources, that include the learning and support materials and learning objects. So this is single window search. This may be one of the useful resources for the researchers. Moodle, you might heard about that. This is one of the most popular learning management system and one of the open source courseware management system, which provide you become very popular among the educators in the world. You can use this platform. Now coming to some of the initiatives of Ministry of Education, there are a number of initiatives from the Ministry of Education, earlier Ministry of HRD. Audiovisual content has been developed by the Ministry of Education. First thing is NPTEL. I think you might know this platform. NPTEL provide the e-learning through online web and video course in the Engineering, Science and Humanities stream. The mission of NPTEL is to enhance the quality of engineering education in the country. And if you search this, you will find number of good video recordings, which are very, very much helpful for the users. Similarly, Swayam platform, now everybody is aware about this. This is massive online courses. The full form of Swayam is the study maps for the active learning for young aspiring minds. This is really a very good platform now and very useful for the users because it's freely, freely available videos, freely available content to the users. So if you are not using this, please start using this Swayam platform and content which is available there. Next one is Swayam Prabha. This is also one of the very important platform for the users. They are having media channels which are devoted to the high quality educational programs 24/7, and the based by the internet center Gandhinagar. Now, what kind of digital content or access ebooks are there?
Hello, Dr. Neeraj Chaurasia, sir.
Yeah, it is visible now.
Yes, sir, it's visible.
How much time I have? Please tell me about that. Accordingly, I will finish because for 1 hour, then I can go through.
No. We don't have 1 hour. Actually, we'll be starting our valedictory session from 1 hour onwards.
How much time I have?
You will have, sir. We'll take few questions also. So I think we can go. We have 5 minutes more, sir.
5 minutes.
Yeah, 5 to 10 minutes, sir.
Okay, just give me 10 minutes. I will type.
Yeah, sure, sir.
So NDLI is also one of the platform, National Digital Library of India. So this is one of the platform which is the IIT Kharagpur is having the create platform, and this is the, you can see this. This is from the MHRD, and number of good things, number of good integration they have done, and they are providing a lot of resources using this platform. You can see this and visit this website. And during this pandemic, they have integrated a lot of resources in that. This South Asian Archive is also one of the platform or the resource which is providing access by this thing. EPG Patsala is there. I think you might be aware about that. This is also one of the very good program from where you can find the quality material on about 70 subjects. Shodhganga, I've already discussed. It covers about 3 lakhs thesis from different kind of universities. About 500 universities are there. Shodhgangotri is the platform. If you are writing your thesis, just go through it, because you will be able to find out what kind of research blueprints are available, what kind of synopsis already submitted. So this is the platform of synopsis or research in progress. This is very important tool for the budding research scholars who are going to. So Shodh-Suddhi is important thing under that initiative. Government is providing access of this plagiarism tool to the Urkund, to the universities and colleges. Currently, there are about 1,000 members and good number of universities, institutions. Enlist is a program under that. The colleges are getting access of resources. Vidyamitra is another platform. This IRINS is very important platform, because it's whatever you are publishing, this is the platform where you can showcase your research. Like, this is the platform which IITDelhi created. You can see we have 625 faculty members. We have about 31,000 publications. So all kind of visibility will be there using this. Vidwan is another platform. You can create your profile using this Vidwan platform, and it will be very easy to find the collaborators and other things. Currently, there are about, if you are looking for an expert, this is the very good platform. You can go through it and you will be find out what kind of experts are there in different fields. So if you are not member of this, you just create this. I'm not going in detail now. I will share this. There are a number of open access data resources from where you can find out the data sets. If you are doing your research in different fields, like if you are doing your research in health and social science field, these are the resources, data sets or data resources, which may be highly useful for you. Similarly, there are data journals, government and global data. If you are doing research in global data or government data, you will be able to find out from these websites. If you are doing research in financial and economic data, these sites from where you are getting the data sets. So I'm not going in detail because of this time positive. And these are the different kind of tools which are available. These are all are hyperlinked. Whenever you are click on this, you will directly connect it to the platform. A number of open data initiatives are there from Government of India. This is OGD, data.gov.in. You will find a lot of initiatives of Government of India, open initiatives. Now, another important thing is institute ranking and e-resource. How this is linked with e-resources. So, institutions are participating in NIRF, sometimes QS ranking, Times Higher Education ranking, Shanghai ranking, India Today, or Outlook ranking. But I'm taking one example of NIRF. If you are participating, your institution is participating in NIRF. There are four components. Out of five components, these two components are directly related to the subscription of procurement of resources. Like, first thing is teaching, learning and resources, PLR. And second one is research and professional practice. So you see this one, PLR, under the first one, fourth one is financial resources, their utilization, including the expenditure on libraries resources. So there are certain point in these ranking, there are 30 for financial resources and their utilization, and 30 points, 15 points are for the library resources. Another 15 points are for the lab resources. See this one. So this is directly related to the ranking. Similarly, for second point of parameter of NIRF, research and professional practices there. That first 2 points, the combined metrics of publications, combined metrics of quality publications. So these are two important points for, which are directly related to the e-resources. Because having subscription of a good number of platforms like Scopus, Web of Science, you will be able to find out what kind of publications are there, what is the impact of that research, what kind of H index is there. So these are directly related to the e-resource subscription. Similarly, in one slide, I have given these four screenshots of four different rankings, like this is Shanghai ranking, this is University ranking, then Times High Education ranking, and QS ranking. So these are directly related to the subscription of e-resources. Apart from that, if you are having subscription of e-journals, e-books, and other e-resources or digital platform, it is very easy to get the publications at right platform. And if you are publishing in good journal and good platforms, your this citations would be increased. And if citations are increased, then H index would be increased for individual and also for the institution. And finally, it will directly affect the ranking of the institutions. I'm not going in detail what are the benefits, but definitely there are a lot of benefits to the users, a lot of benefits to the libraries. And I think we as a library or library science professional, we should start using these resources, electronic resources. And during this current scenario of COVID-19, where students are not in the campus, try to integrate with some of the remote access tools so that whatever you are subscribing, whatever your library is subscribing and spending a lot of budgets on that, at least it should go to the right persons, right users. If it is subscribed by the library and not reaching to the users, definitely not fulfilling the purpose of the users. So anytime, anywhere access should be there. Now, one last two, three slides. Important thing is whenever the library is subscribing the resources, it should be appropriately used. Because if it is not appropriately used, then sometimes users or the library or the institution may be in trouble. Because whatever resources you are subscribing or institute is subscribing, the license agreement is being signed, and there are a number of terms conditions which are directly creating problems. So it is license agreement being signed by the individual or by the publisher or by the institutions, and if you are not following the guideline, then it create problem. And you know, it is governed by the applicable copyright law as well. In this slide, I would like to tell that what are the appropriate use. You should not commercially use whatever resources is available in the library. It should be not commercially used. Downloading or excessive proportion of the resource, it is also not do, because this is prohibited. Entire journal you cannot download. Electronically transmit, you cannot transmit electronically to others. Posting of article on any website, public website, is not permitted. You should not use robots. You should not use robot kind of softwares for getting the resources, for getting the articles downloaded. Otherwise, the institute or the library will be in trouble. They will be having problems. Immediately, the access would be shut down by the publishers for the complete range of students. You should not share the ID password to anyone. And because what is happening, the publishers or vendors, they are having the directly control, and they are carefully monitoring the web activities, whatever you are doing on their platform. And breaches of license terms may be the result of loss of privileges. I've already talked about that. And so specific terms conditions for each resources are generally available on the publisher website. So whatever you are accessing, please be careful about accessing of e-resources, whatever you are accessing. Now, last slide, I would like to tell you that most of the things are covered, but there are, apart from the challenges, there are a lot of opportunities to the users, to the libraries, and to the academic fraternity. And we have to have the access of print. Apart from the print, we should have the electronic resources in the hybrid platform. And this is our responsibility as a librarian to provide the high quality content to the users in the form of e-resources. We should provide access of
things.
Citation databases, infrastructure tools, plagiarism tools, and other tools. And important thing is, whatever free resources are available, try to link all kind of free resources on library website. So it will be very helpful to us to provide access to the entire community of academics. And finally, I'd like to say that the library is set up to change and adopt the new environment, keeping the future needs of the users in the view of the current scenario. So this is all about from my side. And at the end, I'd like to acknowledge all the sincere acknowledge all kind of internet resources, because I have taken these screenshots or the content from different websites, different platforms. And so I'd like to acknowledge to all those resources, because it is very difficult to mention the resource in each and every slide. But I acknowledge to each and every one from where I have taken the data. These are some of the references from where I have taken the data in the platform, this in presentation. Thank you very much once again for giving me this opportunity to speak on this occasion, on this last day of this FTP. And I really congratulate to the organizers for giving this opportunity. I really appreciate for that. Thank you very much once again. Thank you. I think I am on time.
Yes, sir. Sir, thank you so much. You had so much content for presentation today, yet you completed in the specified time. Thank you so much, sir. An announcement for all our participants. Our literary session will start just after this technical session. So participants are requested to stay with us. And continuing this session, I would like to take questions. Sir, there is a question that what is H index and how many classes are there? Hello, sir?
Yeah, it is connected now, yes.
Sir, there's a question. How many types of indices are there?
Can you please repeat?
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, tell me.
Okay. What is H index and how many types of indices are there?
H index, I have already talked about that. H index is very simple. H index is basically the index for getting the citations or getting the total number of citations or total number of publications. What you can do is H index is calculated based on the number of papers you published and number of citations you received. So simple way of calculating the H index is like you make a table. In that table, you write numbers. Suppose you have published 20 papers. So from 1 to 20, write the numbers like 1, 2, 3, up to 20, right? In the second column, you put your all kind of what kind of citations you receive. So higher citations you put in decreasing order, right? And just match that line where both are matching, right? So if you have published 20 papers and received at least 20 citations, then your H index would be 20.
There's a question, how to use Sci-Hub?
Sci-Hub, actually, this is not an authentic thing. I think Sci-Hub, there are a number of court cases which are going on, right? So at least on this platform, I would not suggest to use the Sci-Hub, right? I know that number of users are using Sci-Hub because once they are not getting the papers or not getting the content from anywhere, they are going to the Sci-Hub and getting the access of individual resource. So this is the platform which is very much used by the research scholars. I know that, but there are a lot of issues are there, and the number of publishers, they went to court for that. Sci-Hub was one of the platform for content, for getting the content.
So basically a pirated version.
Sorry?
Basically a pirated version, sir.
Yes, I don't want to talk much about that because I don't want to encourage to use that. First, you try to get the fulfill the your requirement using free resources and your colleagues. There are a number of colleagues which are there, and they definitely may help. If you are not getting from anywhere, then it's fine.
Sir, we'll take one question. Someone wants to know the definition of DELCON. Explain DELCON.
DELCON is basically a consortium, right? I already talked about this DELCON consortia. DELCON is one of the consortia of this DBT consortia, right? I talked about the consortia. There are 10 consortia. Out of 10, one consortia is DELCON. The DELCON consortia is the consortia of this Ministry of DBT consortia, okay? Department of Biotechnology consortia. All the biotechnology institutions are getting the access of resources using this DELCON consortia.
Dr. Lalit Kumar Jha has raised his hand. Is Dr. Lalit Kumar Jha available? Please unmute Dr. Lalit Kumar Jha. Okay, I'll go with the next question. They want to know how to get the link for research paper, which was in UGC care list last year. But now it's not there.
Link of what?
Research paper, which was in UGC care list in the last term. And now no, it's not there.
You see.
Is there a way to get the link of that paper?
I have gone through the yesterday's some of the video where Dr. Singh has discussed about the UGC care list of journals. Basically, what is happening? The UGC care list, you talked about this paper, but basically the UGC care list is having the list of journals. UGC care list doesn't have the access of individual article, right? So there are certain articles which are there in UGC care list of journals. Actually yearly it is reviewed. Sometimes it is happening that currently it is there, but it might not be there in next year. So actually question is not correct, because you are not getting the, you will not be able to find out the individual article. You are talking about article. Basically, it is listing the journals. UGC care list is listing the journals, not the articles. Okay.
Sir,
hello?
Yes.
Can I just add to this? I think all the papers which are included in the Web of Science are now a part of UGC list. So if the paper is enlisted in that, it would mean that according to the new list. Is that right?
Can you please clarify again?
According to previously, what was there was that the UGC used to release list of the journals, said these are the journals which are there. And recently, when it is being taken care by Pune, it is like that any journal, any paper which is enlisted in the Web of Science, that is a part of the UGC care list. So I think if the paper is there in the Web of Science, that means that paper is in the UGC list.
So basically you have rightly pointed out that all the papers which are, all the journals which are included in Web of Science, all journals are in the list of UGC care list. So if your library is subscribing any journal, access of any journal, only then you will be able to find out the article. If you are not subscribing, your institution is not subscribing, because these journals are subscription based. If you don't have subscription, you will not be able to find out the individual article, right?
Sir, Anima Jamwal wants to know that if an article on internet is helpful for students, if an article which they find on the internet is useful for students, can it be shared? Can the link be shared directly to the students?
You see, I have already discussed there are number of free resources, number of subscribed resources. Okay, so if you find anything on free resources, it is available freely on internet, you can definitely share, because this is freely available, and basically you can use for academic and research purpose. All the resources which are available freely, you cannot make money out of that, right? It is definitely available on freely available on internet, and you can use for academic and research purpose.
Sir, can I use Google Scholar to access research papers? Yes. Is it safe?
You see, Google Scholar is one of the platform from where you will be able to find out, you can integrate your all kind of publications, right? For searching the searching any kind of research papers, Google is the platform actually. But I think Google is not the right platform. If you are associated with any of the institutions, so please approach to your library. That is the right approach actually, right? If your library is subscribing something, then that is the right way. Otherwise, Google is always there. You can search, you can find. If you are searching for free resources, you will definitely find out whatever available. But Google Scholar is different.
Sir, EBSC or Discovery Services, can we access it on iitdelhi.ac.in?
No,
we can get papers.
You see, this is one of the platform. You can access it, but you will not be able to find out full text, right? Because this is IP-based system. It will not be accessible from outside the campus. Okay, this is integrated. All resources are integrated, but you will be able to find out only details, means bibliographical detail of the papers, right? But out of the campus, you will not be able to find out if you are not authorized user of IIT campus, IIT Delhi.
Sir, opens any textbooks with the help of that website, we can access any textbook of physics?
Yes, you see, I cannot tell what you can access, what not. But this is one of the platform which I have already given link to you. Now it is up to you. You have to search. I have to analyze the individual website, right? You see, definitely everything will not be freely available. But if you are not having anything, so there are some of the free resources which can be used for you, right? Definitely everything will not be available. Otherwise, from where the publishers will be getting the revenue, right? They have to run their business. They have to run their store. So there are few ebooks which are freely available. Definitely complete ebooks of whatever you want. It might not be available or might not be available on the different platforms.
Thank you so much, sir.
Eshwat Sindhu.
Yeah, Eshwat Sindhu. I have already
talked. Eshwat Sindhu can be used to access thesis or dissertations.
No, I think you have not clearly gone through. I will share the PPTs.
Yes, sir.
Eshwat Sindhu is different thing. Eshwat Sindhu is source. Yeah. Shodh Ganga is the platform, right? Shodh Ganga is the platform where, as per the UGC notification of 2009, there was a mandatory requirement of universities that they have to submit the thesis after publishing. They have to mandatory submit the thesis to Shodh Ganga, right? So Shodh Ganga, there are 3 lakh theses which are available. You will be able to find out the thesis, full text thesis, which are available, which are deposited by the individual universities. There are more than 500 universities.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
I think there are no more questions. Sir,
I think there was one question, H index, what kind of index?
What is H index?
No, I think I have already replied that. But
yes.
Another part of that question was,
how many types of indices are there?
So indexes, there are number of indexes available, like H index is one. I-10 index is there. I-10 index is basically for it is taking information from Google Scholar, right? Once you register with Google Scholar, you will find H index, I-10 index. So I-10 index means the papers which has at least 10 citations, right? If your paper has more than 10 or more than 10 citations, then your H index could be accordingly. Your 10 papers are having 10 citations or more than 10, then your I-10 index would be 10. Similarly, there are G index, there are I index, there are a number of other indexes are there. So these are the different kind of metrics of different citation databases.
So there's one question. If is for any journal which is not in UGC care list, will it be countable in API?
No, I think currently it is a big problem. if you go through the actually API is no more, I think, right? API system was there in 6th pay commission, right? In 7th pay commission, the UGC guidelines are entirely different. There is no points now, right? There are different kind of mechanism is there, but definitely if it is not under UGC care list or Scopus index or DevOps Science index, then you will not be getting that kind of weightage.
So thank you so much, sir. And we are really having very good feedback from the participants regarding your session. So thank you once again for this very, very informative session. You have given lots of information on important databases, citation indices, impact factor, open SSE resources, and so on. I believe this topic will be very beneficial to all the faculties and research scholars and in helping us in establishing a state-of-art library. I now request Mrs. Sapna Jujaria, Madam, in charge of Department of Library and Information Science, to present, to say a few words. Dr. Mrs. Sapna, Madam.
Thank you so much, Mrs.
हेलो, आप हमारे बीच में आए और आप आपने हमें इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स मीडिया देन ई रिसोर्सेज के बारे में काफी कुछ इंफॉर्मेशन प्रोवाइड की, जो कि इट्स अ वेरी यूजफुल फॉर द फैकल्टी मेंबर्स देन स्कॉलर्स रिसर्च और स्कॉलर्स आल्सो. सो इट्स अ वेरी इंफॉर्मेटिव सेशन फॉर अस सर. सो थैंक्स टू दिस वन सर. थैंक यू सो मच
सर. मैडम Neeraj sir will be sharing his PPT with us, and we'll definitely share this PPT with the participants because we have a lot of requests for that. So we'll conclude this session. I express my heartfelt gratitude to our principal heads for their participation and their presence, and also the participants for their wonderful feedback. My sincere and utmost thanks from the bottom of my heart to our resource person today, Dr. Neeraj Chaurasia sir, for his valuable and very informative session. My thanks to the organizing and technical committee for their wholehearted support in the success of this session. Thank you very much. The next session will be followed by the valedictory session. I request sir to remain with us. You can take a break of 5 minutes, sir. We'll start with the next session, and I request all the participants to be with us. There's a request to all the participants to kindly switch on their video in short. Amit sir, Dr.
Hello,
Patidhar sir,
am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Patidhar sir, are we ready for a screenshot?
Thoda sa iska voice banana.
Done, ma'am, done.
Dr. Neeraj Chaurasia, so you can just take a break of 1 minute if you want. Can we have the video, please? Can we have the video, please?
Institute of Science and Lab Education, IPS Academy, is one of the premier educational institutes in Central India, imparting education in the field of basic sciences. It started in the year 2001 Since then, the institute has seen a phenomenal growth, and today the department offers courses both 6 undergraduate and 6 postgraduate levels in biotechnology, chemistry, computer science, electronics, mathematics, physics, and library science. To get hands-on experience of various experimental and analytical techniques in different streams of sciences, the institute has the advantage of providing state-of-the-art science laboratories. Along with regular courses, ISLE runs various value-added courses also for skill development to enhance the capabilities of the students to make them skilled for employment. Physics. The physics department designs and fabricates the innovative equipments for the students' laboratory purpose and even supplies to different educational institutes. Also, students of physics design and fabricate the electronic kits under the skill development project.